From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. Just for knowing, I'm not Deborah Taylor. You'll be hearing from Deborah shortly. I'm Karen Jaffe, head of the Young Reader Center, and welcome to the Library of Congress Symposium on Diversity in Children's Literature, Using Books and Stories to Strengthen Families, a Multicultural Perspective. This is sponsored by the Center for the Book and the Young Reader Center, and we're honored to have a panel of renowned authors and a distinguished moderator who will address this topic, focusing on teen literacy and family representations from their various cultural perspectives. This symposium is inspired to a large degree by El Día de los Niños, El Día de los Libros, loosely translated as Children's Day Book Day. Traditionally celebrated on Thursday, on April 30th, which is today, and it's DIA for short. This morning, for example, and for the second year in a row, Meg Medina led a bilingual program with her book, Tia Isa Needs a Car, with 50 first graders from the Oyster Adams School in Washington, D.C., celebrating the spirit of DIA and the importance of literacy for children of all linguistic and cultural backgrounds. But our goal this afternoon is to recognize that DIA has become something more than individual programs and events, important as they are, to celebrate diversity, but a critical part of our community and culture for all of us. We don't have to look very far to understand why this might be important. From Ferguson to Staten Island to Charleston, and now less than an hour away in Baltimore, we've seen how racial violence, often involving young people, have threatened and divided cities. Last December, the Washington Post published a commentary by three early childhood educators from the University of Texas, Austin, in which they talked about teaching tolerance starting in kindergarten, and their main theme was to teach diversity early. So how can we, books for children and teens, make a difference, and why is it important? We hope to explore some of those questions today. We've made some progress. Launched about a year ago, the nonprofit grassroots organization We Need Diverse Books, and thank you, Ellen, for the buttons, led by our panelist, Ellen O, and made up of many authors, educators, and others, has spearheaded this conversation. The American Library Association has mounted a DIA Diversity Action Initiative and held an all-day conference the day before their midwinter meeting this past January. Earlier this month, the AWP, the Association of Writers at Book Fair, held a number of sessions about how writers could incorporate multicultural themes in their work. And the Children's Book Council, representing the American book publishers, has their own diversity initiative, and some of their members have launched their own projects. The CBC has also partnered with the ALA and was a co-sponsor of the January conference. And I just learned about a children's publisher in the UK who's trying through a campaign to increase the space for minority voices in children's publishing there. Now, before beginning our conversation, I'd just like to take a minute to thank the important representatives from the Library of Congress who've made this day possible. From the Center for the Book, Ann Bonney, Guy LaMolinara, and our boss, John Cole. From the Young Reader Center, my colleagues Kaheen Muhammad and Monica Valentine, and our many volunteers who are here today, all of whom provided hours of their time and ingenuity and talent to make this day a reality. Would you stand, please, all my folks? Thank you. And very specifically, and you don't have to stand, I wish to thank Meg Medina, who fostered this idea for this program and nurtured it to this day. And finally, a note about our program format. After hearing from our panelists, we'll devote the last 20 minutes to Q&A. So please hold your questions until that time. And when you're ready to ask a question, we will have three microphones. Please wait till you get a microphone. This is being recorded, and we want to pick up all the information. By participating in this event, you're giving us permission to be part of this webcast. And anyone who's on our email list will get a notice of when that webcast will be posted on the library website. We also encourage you to share your ideas through Twitter. Our hashtag is Young Readers Diversity. And now to get the show on the road. Our moderator today is, in fact, Deborah Taylor, who's coordinator of school and student services for the Enoch Pratt Free Library in Baltimore, and who recently received the Virginia Hamilton Lifetime Achievement Award from the American Library Association. You have a lot of fans. She's also the 2015 chair of the ALA Seibert Award for Outstanding Informational Books for Children. She's served on many ALA committees, including the Coretta Scott King Book Awards, the Michael L. Prince Award Committee, the Newbery Awards Committee. She's also served on the Boston Globe Horn Book Award Committee and has reviewed for Horn Book and Kirkus. From 1996 to 97, she was president of the Young Adult Library Service Association of the American Library Association, and she's also taught young adult literature at University of Maryland iSchool and children's literature at Towson University. It's my pleasure to turn the program over to Deb Taylor.
Wow, good afternoon. It's so great to see so many people here because we have a very important opportunity. We are probably living under that Confucius curse of living in interesting times. So the best thing that we can do with those interesting times is to learn from them and then to apply our best abilities to making those interesting times better times. Now, I'm a librarian, as you heard, so my introductions are in alphabetical order. Unfortunately, our panelists are not seated in alphabetical order, so I'm going to ask them to just wave when I call their name. Kwame Alexander is a poet and author of 18 books, most recently The Crossover, which received the 2015 John Newbery Medal for the most distinguished contribution to American literature for children. His other works include the award-winning picture book Acoustic Rooster and His Barnyard Band, recently optioned as a children's television show, and He Said, She Said, a YA novel. Kwame uses poetry to inspire and empower young people through his Book a Day literacy program, which has created more than 3,000 student authors across the US, Canada, and the Caribbean. And Kwame lives with his family in Reston, Virginia. Gigi Amateau's first book for young adults, Claiming Georgia Tate, was published by Candlewick Press in 2005, and it was selected as a New York Public Library book for the teenage. Gigi is also the author of four additional books, including Come August, Come Freedom, her first work of historical fiction, which won the Library of Virginia's People's Choice Award for Fiction and was chosen by the Virginia Library Association as a Jefferson Cup Honor Book. Gigi lives with her family in Richmond, where she is the children's book correspondent for the Richmond Times-Dispatch. Welcome, Gigi. Meg Medina is an award-winning Cuban-American author who writes picture books, middle grade, and YA fiction. She is the 2015 recipient of the Pura Belpre Medal for her young adult novel, Yaki Delgado Wants to Kick Your Ass. We love that title. I want you to know that. She is also the 2012 Ezra Jack Keats New Writers Medal winner for her picture book, Tia Issa Wants a Car. And when she is not writing, Meg works on community projects that support girls, Latino youth, and literacy. And she lives with her family in Richmond, Virginia. Welcome. Ellen O is co-founder and president of We Need Diverse Books, a grassroots organization of children's book lovers that advocates essential changes in the publishing industry to produce and promote literature that reflects and honors the lives of all young people. She is the author also of the highly acclaimed and best-selling YA fantasy trilogy, The Prophecy Series. She was named one of Publishers Weekly Notable People of 2014, and Ellen lives in Bethesda, Maryland with her husband and three daughters. Welcome, Ellen. Tim Tingle is an Oklahoma Choctaw, an award-winning author and storyteller. His great-great-grandfather, John Carnes, walked the Trail of Tears in 1835, and his paternal grandmother attended a series of rigorous Indian boarding schools in the early 1900s. Responding to a scarcity of Choctaw lore, Tingle began collecting tribal stories in the early 90s. His latest middle grade novel, How I Became a Ghost, Roadrunner Press, May of 2013, pulls heavily from interviews with tribal elders. And Tim's books, Salty Pie and Trickster, were selected as ALA notable books. And Tim comes to us from Texas. Welcome, Tim. Well, we have such a distinguished panel, and we thought that, given the theme of today's event, that we would ask each panelist to respond to kind of an opening question, and then I'm hopefully going to listen very carefully so that if things come up in their comments, that we can then follow up, so it's not so stilted so that everybody's just walking down the line. But I would like to start with Gigi, because I'm going to start at the other end.
Settling in, actually.
That's okay. Uh-oh. We're all family here. And I'd like to, for each of our panelists to think about the question and respond to the question, how has your family experience informed your work?
Thank you. I love that question. So I think there's a balance, you know, sort of, stories are made up of characters and conflict and a sense of place. And some people's stories are made up of plot. That's not my favorite. Plot isn't. But I would say family, for me, informs really all of that. I was so fortunate when I was in my early childhood, the 0 to 6 formative years, where it's so important to, we know from years of resiliency research, right, for young children to have in their lives at least one loving adult who is stable and present and in their life consistently. So I was very fortunate. I was born to teenage parents. My parents were juniors in high school. But I had 4 grandparents in my town. And so for me, my work never strays far from a love of elders. And so I see in all my work, even when I'm writing about horses and from the perspective of horses, those horses are old. They're elders. So I'd say in that sense, sort of grounding me to place and to that mirror that is an older person in a child's life, really, really holding up a mirror that can reflect back sort of that best self that we aspire to be. And I'd say on the side of conflict, probably, you know, maybe all of us touch this emotion at some point in our lives, but you know, I have a thing about abandonment, and I think that comes from having teen parents who were just too young, really, to deal with being equipped to be good presence and so good parents. And so for me, sort of the absence, I think of my father, whether I want it to inform my work or not, it always does by what's there, and oftentimes by what's not there. And so I think it all always comes back to really, it's my family experiences that give me access, you know, an entry point into the story, whether it's an emotional entry point of a strong feeling or an entry point into a character.
Okay, thank you. Great. Tim?
I knew from the time I was in the second grade that I wanted to be a writer. I was raised hearing two stories, and I was forbidden to tell anyone. My closest friend, my Sunday school teacher, neighbors, school teachers, anyone, even kids my age, that we were American Indian. My grandmother left Oklahoma, it was very dangerous times, and moved to Pasadena, Texas. And when she was at boarding school, they say she used to step out and long before the sun came up and make her way to a tiny little woods and a lake beyond it, and she would sing Amazing Grace in Choctaw, which is now our national anthem. And she grew up telling people that if you don't sing Amazing Grace, the sun will never rise. And she stepped out her first day in the Texas Gulf Coast, away from Choctaw Nation, Oklahoma, feeling as if finally she's come to a place where she doesn't have to fear quite so much. And she stepped out on the front porch to sing Amazing Grace, and neighborhood kids had been told that an Indian was coming into the community, and they pelted her with rocks and cut her face. So she didn't step out that front door for 50 years again, until she got so old and my grandfather had died and we needed a family picture. And she cried and cried, and finally she was ushered out to the front porch and she took a few pictures and came back inside. Well, I knew the story of my grandmother and how she eventually overcame that and let us know to be proud of who we were. That needed to be told. And then I was, along with my 32 cousins, we were tossed into the back of pickup trucks every summer and driven 200 miles to the big thicket of East Texas, which was a huge, not national forest, but a wild country then, with wolves and coyotes and every kind of snake imaginable. We could bring only water, salt, sugar, coffee, and eggs. We would hike for a full day, and everything we ate for the week had to be either caught or fished for or hunted for. But the real purpose of bringing us to that isolated area, when we'd finished supper and crawled into our sleeping bags, then my dad and his brothers and uncles would tell us about John Carnes and the Trail of Tears and my grandmother and the boarding school and what it meant to be Choctaw. But before we would leave at the end of the week, they would always tell us, remember the promise you make to mama, to your grandmother. You cannot tell anyone. This is for us. This is for only family to know. We cannot tell. So it was in the 70s when my grandmother had an eye operation and her blindness was gone. She had an eye transplant, cornea transplant, that the family got together and started telling stories the day it was determined that she could see. For the first time, she could see her grandkids. And we decided it's time to be proud of who we are. It's time to be proud. No more hiding. It's time to tell the stories. It's time to be proud. And I knew I had the story of my grandmother and the story of my four times great-grandfather who survived the Trail of Tears, carrying the bones of his mother so they could be buried at the new home in Oklahoma. She died on the trail. And I thought, I'll write books about those two stories, and that's enough. That's all I have to say. But then in digging and digging and digging and researching, of course, you run across more stories than you could ever tell in a lifetime. But everything I write is about family. Thank you.
That's amazing. Ellen?
My turn?
Yep.
So I was a really violent kid. And, I mean, I blame my dad. My dad has this thing, he say, if somebody hits you once, you hit them back 10 times harder. And I believed in this, except it's not really good advice when everybody's bigger than you. But you know, I grew up in New York, and I grew up a kid of immigrant parents, and they spoke broken English, and I had to deal with a lot of racism. And to be honest, I got called chink a lot, and it would drive me crazy because, you know, I'm a gook, not a chink. I mean, if you're gonna use a racial slur, you better call me by the right one. You know, but ultimately, what happens is that it affects your self-worth. So what helped me come out of kind of the spiraling self-hatred that I think a lot of immigrant kids do go through was that my father is also a writer, and he would tell me stories. And he would tell me stories about running away from the communist army, you know, in Korea, and living off rice balls that only had salt in it. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm eating a Twinkie, and I'm going, oh my God, just rice balls and salt? And I realized that there was this whole culture and this whole heritage that I really had no exposure to growing up in the States and going to American schools. And that really kind of formed who I was. And to be honest, family is all about what I write, because that my dad and my mom, they're all part of the characters that come out in my writing. You know, if I have my wise king, it's because my dad's wise. And if I have a goofy monk, it's because my dad's goofy. And you know, I have a queen character because she's majestic, and I think my mom's one of my biggest heroes, and so is my dad. So I find that everything I do when I write, it comes down to family.
You know, I remember talking to an editor and telling her that I had written this novel about two brothers who play basketball. And up until that time, I had written a picture book, and I'd also written a young adult novel. And this particular book was for middle grade students. And the editor said, Kwame, you're trying to do too much. Why do you think, you can't write in every genre. You kind of have to find one thing and stick to that. So I'm not too sure that this crossover thing is gonna work. And I was like, all right. And I said, have a great day. And I went on about my business. And I started thinking, when you asked that question, Deb, what made me think that I could do anything, that I could write whatever I wanted to write? What gave me sort of that level of confidence, of self-worth? And here it is. I published my first book in 1995. It was a collection of poems, mainly love poems, because I had been writing love poems at Virginia Tech for this woman. And submitting these poems in Nikki Giovanni's class and getting C's. But I decided I was a love poet and I was gonna publish this book, and I got 100 rejections, callaloo. Nobody wanted to publish my book, so I published it in the first place I sold books. Like, I bought a booth at this conference called Furious Flower in 1994 at James Madison. I bought a booth. Maybe Dr. Gavin gave me the booth for free because I didn't have a lot of money, but I sold a lot of books. What made me think that I could pretty much do whatever I wanted to do writerly, from a writerly standpoint? I was 11 years old. My father was the headmaster of a school called Yuhuru Sasa in Brooklyn, New York. Yuhuru Sasa is Swahili for freedom now. And 3,000 kids at this school, all African-American kids, were being taught our self-worth, to feel proud of who we are. And one morning, I wake up, and I'm ready to go to school. I'm all excited, and my mother says, you're not going to school today. Today, you're going to a field trip. I'm like, okay, cool. Where are we going? And my mother says, today you're going to march over the Brooklyn Bridge. And I say, why are we going to march over the Brooklyn Bridge? Well, we're going to protest the racist regime that Ed Koch, the mayor of New York, leads. Well, what does that have to do with me? I just want to go to school. Well, all of the students in school are going to march with the community. Well, I think I'm gonna opt out of this. I cried, I threw a tantrum. There was no way I was gonna march over this bridge, because in my 11-year-old head, I knew that if we made it across the bridge, which we weren't because they were gonna open the bridge and we were gonna fall in, but if we made it across the bridge, there would be police on horses with dogs, and we were all going to die. And my father, for the most part, dragged me out of the house and made me march over the bridge. And going across the bridge was sort of a life-changing moment for me. We're fired up. We can't take no more. We're fired up. We're chanting. And by the time I get across the bridge, and I'm literally in the front line because my dad is the headmaster, and I'm face to face with these police on horses and dogs, I had sort of reached this point in my life, in my development as a sort of man-child in the promised land, that you can do whatever you want. You have to be steadfast, you have to persevere, you have to be persistent, you have to be focused, you have to be determined, you have to know what it is you want in this world, and you have to go after it, and you cannot be afraid. And that's what I've tried to do as a writer. Wow.
Meg?
It's really hard to be last. I just want to put that out there, people. So family, I think, is at the root of absolutely everything I write. My family came from Cuba in 1959, in 1960, 61, and then aunts and uncles and so on in the late 60s and early 70s. So my family's experience was the experience of immigrants. It was the experience of political refugees. And the men were gone. Right? So my dad was not in the family. My uncle, unfortunately, passed away. My grandfathers did too. So I was raised by tías and my mother and mis abuelas, and they were all these strong and yet frightened women at the same time, trying to make sense of New York City in the 70s, trying to raise two daughters with, you know, feminism was on the rise, and New York was a very violent kind of place at the time. They had lost their sense of identity in terms of jobs and careers, and language. It's an amazing loss when you cannot communicate who you are and what you know and how you see the world with words. So I remember my family as being eccentric, as struggling, as being a family that had longing. And the longing they most had was for Cuba, which was such a huge part of our life. But for me, born here, it was like a phantom limb. I could feel it, I could almost see it, but I'd never experienced it. So when I sit down to write, I'm interested in the bicultural experience. That kid who lives both in the United States as American, but also as something else. And all of those really nuanced negotiations that have to happen for that child. But as I write, I try to celebrate the women who loved me and who raised me with all of their imperfections and their fears. And I try to create a loving and complicated portrait of a contemporary Latino family. And I think that for Latinos, really for every ethnic group, we owe people authentic representations. And that's what I really try to do.
Great.
Now the next questions, until we reach the Q&A period, just want to put the questions out there, and however you feel you want to respond in what order, you can just whoever fight for the mic or whoever speaks up
first.
I'm
not going last. And
I, well, Meg, I will let you go first.
Yay.
With
I'm
this
ready.
One, because it comes from something you just said.
Okay.
You talked about the bicultural experience, and I wrote down bicultural versus wholeness. Is there a point where there becomes that need, and many kids, and if we, as we get to a majority, minority, or whatever version of that it is, where you're dealing with two or three or multiple cultures, and all of our goal is to aim towards wholeness. Mm. How does that bicultural experience either hinder the move towards wholeness as a person or assist the movement towards wholeness?
Well, you know, I think there are universal
dramas of growing up, right?
Oh, yeah. So I think that for me, and maybe Ellen will, this will resonate with Ellen, there are whole periods of time when you're a bicultural kid where you're sort of ashamed of your family's situation, their accents, their habits, the food they eat. You know, I would never have taken a tamal to lunch at school, even though it's like one of my favorite things in the whole wide world. So there's this whole growth period of learning how your culture isn't something to get past. For a long time, I believed that I had to get past and assimilate and become Brady Bunch-ish, Partridge Family-ish. You know, I used to study these shows almost like a detective. Strange, like there's a study. They sit down and they're grounded. I mean, you know, things like that. How odd. So I think that there was that period of discomfort and dissonance, and I see that in young people who I visit in schools now. It's only later that you figure out all the gifts that provided you, all the ways of seeing, all the, frankly, the empathy, the ability to sit in somebody else's shoes and consider things from different points of view. I don't know, what do you think? Am I on the right track here? Save me, in other words. Go.
I'll go next. Okay.
Yeah, that was
good. So I can totally relate with what Meg was saying about the tamale, because when I was growing up, my mom would pack me these awesome Korean, like, little bento boxes for lunch. And I would be ashamed to eat it at school because the kids would make fun of it. I mean, like, you know, Korean kimbap, which is like, you know, seaweed wrapped around rice and meat and vegetables. They'd be like, ew, seaweed, oh my God, it's the grossest thing in the world, as they're sitting there eating their stinky cheese sandwich. So I personally ended up eating a lot of lunches at home after school, you know, starving to death. And in some ways, times have changed because my kids, their favorite thing to pack is like rice and seaweed. Like, you can buy Korean kim, like the seaweed, at Costco. I mean, this is kind of unbelievable. So like, from that aspect, I think that's wonderful, you know, going into supermarkets and being able to see the array of different cultural, you know, food items that are available. And I guess in some ways, it always does start with the food, because, you know, food is such a warm family, homey kind of place to relate. And so one day I have to write a cookbook. But anyway, I think that cultural heritage that people have as growing up from an immigrant family is that hard place of being between, you know, assimilating into the American society and still trying to kind of keep your heritage and be proud of where you are. And it is funny that nowadays food seems to be more of an equalizer, but it doesn't take away from the fact that there is still issues of racial tensions and people not understanding culture beyond the food aspect. So I do think we still have a long way to go.
Well, this idea of other and how, as bicultural people or people who are of color, as it were, I think the issue is not with sort of us. Like, we understand the value of who we are. The problem, I believe, happens when the other kids don't view us as a part of the whole, that we become outside of this wholeness. And so I think the wholeness thing, I think what we should also be looking at is that we were talking about Baltimore and Ferguson, and in Claudia Rankine's book, Citizen, or when she was at the LA Festival of the Book, she gave this amazing quote that until white men can police their imaginations, black men will keep dying. And so what that says to me is, what kind of books are librarians giving to children? in elementary school, in middle school. Are you giving kids books that feature characters who look like Ellen or who have cultural traditions that Ellen shares during Asian American Heritage Month? Or are you making that a part of sort of the wholeness that you talked about?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Are we giving books to our children that reflect the kind of world we say we want them to live in and participate in? And by far and large, what I've seen is that we are not there yet. And so the problem is not the children. I have a 6-year-old who goes to Lake Ann, and in her mind, yeah, she's brown skin, and she's got this friend who's peach, and that's sort of, okay, that's cool. But at some point, as the parents and the librarians and the teachers, we begin to sort of make those things other. And that's where the problem starts. So I think the wholeness, I make a suggestion that you want a librarian, you want to give a white kid, a male, a book, don't just automatically go to the default. You know, why not give this kid The Great Green Heist? Or why not give this kid Eddie Redd? You know, I think we're the problem, I think.
I just want to echo, I think, Kwame, you've really put it in a very compelling way, and what I'm getting from that, and I agree with it, is that the construct of divisiveness really, it comes from grown-ups, it comes from us. And so I'll tell you a funny story about my daughter. She's 22. When she was about 4, at that age, just beginning to explore language and moving past picture books, she really had a desire to learn about American Indians in our region, who are primarily Algonquin, and she would devour everything, and went to the library and said to the librarian, and she had a lisp at the time, "I'd like to read about Native Americans." And the librarian said, "Okay, what do you mean?" And she said, "You know, Choctaw, Cherokee, Powhatan." So she sat down, the librarian sat down with her and really went through the whole, it was an emergent curriculum moment, right? So the desire to go down this road and learning about sort of distinctions and changes and how we're all kind of part of the whole was coming naturally from her. My mom took her to a powwow on the Mattapani, and she came home and was reading this book. And so here she said to me, she said, "Mom, I've never told this story in public, but she said, Mom, I want you to tell me when you see a white person." I said, "What?" "I want you to tell me the next time you see a white person." I said, "Okay." It was like the most challenging parenting moment of my life. And so I said, "So, got some news for you." "We're white." and everything kind of imploded. And she said, I'm light brown. I said, so that was a moment to say, so when we use the word white, talking about a person, we mainly mean people whose ancestors have come from Europe. Mm-hmm. And that's the story of our family. Our family came from Scotland and from Ireland and from England. But white people took land. That's right. And so for us, it was a moment to try to understand the context of our family and also what that meant in the 20th century, moving into the 21st century, in terms of claiming a different legacy for our family. We can't deny kind of the road that we traveled, but we can take that moment to sort of say, now let's break it down, because we're all working on this together, or it's not working, I think.
Mm-hmm. Going back to just briefly the food as cultural and racial identifying, it was very easy to be a hidden Choctaw because our sacred food is corn. I could eat cornbread, I could eat corn on the cob, I could eat, you know.
Popcorn.
So it was popcorn, you bet. So I was being Choctaw and eating all those things. It was cool. But being of both, and I think about this often, and I've thought about this for decades, about having a foot in both worlds, having a foot in both worlds. And I used to talk about how I would have this overwhelming sense of being Choctaw every time I would cross the Red River that separates Texas from Oklahoma. Now, because of the water situation, it's kind of the Red Creek. You could wade across it, but still, it's there. It's there. I started maybe 15 years ago when I got very serious about writing. I'd been doing storytelling for about 10 years. And I realized that if I wanted the stories to last, they needed to be in some form of print because I won't be here forever. And I discovered that if I had something called writer's block, that I could go to a small town in Oklahoma, tiny little town, tiny little motel, and stay for 3 or 4 days and just start walking out on the hills. And eventually you're going to run across mounds, just little dirt mounds. Little mounds of dirt that you think, well, there was some kind of a wash or some kind of a, you know, who knows how it happened. But we Choctaws knows how it happened. That's our burial mounds, the little burial mounds. And if you notice that usually at one end of them, if it's still there, there'll be a little pile of stones. And the stones block up a doorway that's always there so the spirit can come and go. The spirit can come and go. And this is a belief that is still there with us. That there is no, the word for goodbye in Choctaw is chupisalachiki. It means I will see you in the future, and it literally means that. Chupisalachiki, I will see you in the future. When someone dies, there's the pain and the immediacy of death, but there's always the smile that comes shortly thereafter of, now they see me in everything I do. I better best behave myself, you know, a little bit better. But for us to live in both worlds, I think two things that come from ancient times and from the head of our Choctaw government even today, there are two things that characterize us as people. And one is the ability to use humor to help us overcome. Not to ignore what's going on, but to let us see the humor in the most despicable of wrongs and tragedies to help us overcome. And the other is the power of forgiveness. The power of forgiveness. And that's part of every State of the Nation address by our elected chief. It's part of our folk tales. The heroes of the folk tales are not the ones that slayed the most and waved the spear. They're the ones that bring people together and figure out a way to build the bridges. Just to close with this, Kevin Gover, who's head of NMAI, National Museum of American Indian, he uses a phrase. He says, when people want to learn about American Indians, they come to us sometimes. They bring every stereotype in the books because that's how we're raised in America. And so we could assault them with one speech or portrait after another to show that we're modern people, about what it was done for. He said, but we choose not to do that. We choose to greet them on the bridge they cross upon, and one step at a time, to help them to a better awareness of who we are. And when they sense an uncomfortableness about this is too much about Indians, I don't know this, I didn't want to, then just bid them good day and say the door's always open. But we greet them on the bridge they cross upon. And I think that's so critical in beginning to break down the barriers for racism.
Great. You know, you'll all have to take my word for this because I'm probably older than practically everybody in the room and certainly older than everybody on the panel. But there have been many advocates for greater diversity in children's literature. It springs up every once in a while. But I do think this has gotten a little bit more traction this time around. And I'd like to ask the panel, why do you think that this particular movement, one that Ellen's organization is kind of the face of, that with the title, We Need Diverse Books. Why do you think this particular time in our history, in children's book world, why do you think it's gaining traction right now? And whoever wants to begin.
I'm going to just jump in really quickly, because Ellen will have a lot to say on this, I'm sure, but that it's because that's who's in the seats. I mean, I go to schools now, I look out, and they're from everywhere, and that's the best news of all. They have this wonderful opportunity to learn in live time, authentic relationships with each other, deep friendships across all kinds of lines, not only cultural lines, but students with disabilities in their classroom, like every kind of difference. I just don't think that there's a way to sustain one model of story when the readers out there have so many different realities.
Now, does teacher have to call on someone now?
Okay. So I kind of go back to the food analogy, too, because I do think that we've become smaller, the world, and in a lot of ways, we are so much more aware of the world and the cultures and the people all around us and also in this country. Again, food seems to be the easiest way to start that conversation. And if for some reason people are more inclined to try something new to eat than try to read a book about a different culture, I don't know. But I'm sure everybody's eaten Chinese food, but I don't know how many of you have read Chinese mythology. So, like, again, I think sometimes they're the easier ways to start through to something. Books have to be kind of the next thing. Opening the eyes of children to other cultures, other religions, and, you know, lifestyles, genders, everything. It's, diversity is everywhere. I find that one of the most interesting comments I get is a white person who said, I grew up in an all-white area. I've never seen any diversity. And I said, you're not looking very closely. There's LGBTQIA in your community. There are disabilities community members there. There's a lot of diversity everywhere. And I think that's also why We Need Diverse Books has been maybe had a little bit of a broader scope in that way, because it wasn't just race-based. It was a larger conversation, more encompassing. Go ahead, Meg.
And you know the other thing about We Need Diverse Books, it's really true from the inside out, I'm telling you. The people who led this movement with Ellen were extremely savvy about social media. They're young, they're bright, they really know the ins and outs of Tumblr and Twitter, and I'll tell you, the parents of the kids in your class are those people. Right. So I think that has been, it's just shocking to see the impact of a Twitter campaign as it when it's really managed well. Okay, I know.
I want to toss out a challenge to every one of you. How many librarians are here? Librarians. I want to toss out a challenge.
Yay.
I want for you, when you get back to your library, to try to find the books that, the illustrated books that depict American Indians in modern clothing, that show us as modern people. Try to find those books. Try to find the books that show American Indians as modern people. That is our biggest challenge today, is something so very basic to be recognized that we still exist as modern people. Because unless we're depicted as that in children's books, we will be an invisible race. We don't want to be invisible anymore.
I think that one of the reasons that we're sort of seeing this We Need Diverse Books movement gaining some serious traction is because of all the work that has been put in to diversity and multicultural children's literature over the past 30, 40 or years.
Yeah.
So, like, in my mind, when I go to the Virginia Festival for the Book, and I've been for the past 3 or 4 years, it's one of the most diverse festivals I've been to. And that didn't just happen because We Need Diverse started a movement. when I think of Karibu Books, and I know one of the owners, Karibu Books was an African-American bookstore chain, 6 bookstores, that was here in the DC metropolitan area for at least 10 or 15 years. That was happening before We Need Diverse Movement. When I think of the work, Deb had me on a panel at the Enoch Pratt Library about 10 years ago. I want to say 10 years ago. It was me and John Green. Before John Green was John Green.
Right.
Now, in some people's eyes, that may be, oh, cool, Deb did a diverse panel. No, Deb just was smart enough to put John Green and Kwame Alexander on a panel because she knew they were writers and they had something to offer. I think We Need Diverse Books is gaining traction because America is ready for it, as evidenced by the fact that there are so many diverse things already happening. And Ellen is brilliant and savvy and clever enough to realize that I can sort of take these things that are already happening and give them an umbrella that's going to propel this thing in an amazingly fast and efficient and productive manner.
Can you write my answers for me from now? That was great. But you know, the one thing I want to add on to that is that when we're looking at an audience like this, clearly you guys are already, you know, on board. We are all, we're kind of preaching to the choir here. But going back to what Kwame was saying about the gatekeepers being the problem is not here. These gatekeepers here is not the problem. It's kind of the ones that are still not ready to accept that what we've already kind of accepted as a real reality, as, you know, a true measure of what our real world looks like. Like, for example, not that long ago, I was at a bookstore, and a little white girl was reading Mighty Miss Malone. And if you guys know that book, it has a, you know, on the cover, there's a little black girl on there. And it's a great book, and I was just about to go over and say, hey, that's a really good book. Her mom came over and took it out of her hands and said, no, that's not for you. And this happens more often than you think.
Yeah.
And that's the narrative that has to change.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we're pushing for.
Yeah, I mean, when you think about YA books, and Ellen writes YA, and, well, most of us write YA. When you think about YA books, and this is a question I ask some of my writer friends, do you see white students with YA novels with black pictures on the front? Like, is that something you would see in a school? No. Well, judging by the quietness in the room, right? Like, you just don't see that. I mean, but, so why is it?
But they're walking down the hall with Jay-Z in their ear.
But they're walking down the hall with Jay-Z.
Yeah. And Beyonce in the other ear.
Right, right. So, you know, yeah, it's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's put Beyonce on the cover.
Oh, there you go.
Gigi wanted to jump in.
I'll just jump in quickly to say, I think one of the reasons that We Need Diverse Books is really getting traction right now is that I see in my daughter's group of kids and younger a real articulated desire to belong. And I think the sense of belonging really speaks less to the material or the physical aspect of being a human being than to the spirit of being a human being. And so to me, I think that's what the We Need Diverse Books really taps into, that helping folks, all of us, through story, to find that place, wherever it is, whatever it looks like, culturally or racially or class or religion, finding the place that echoes back to your experience. So in my day job, I'm the chief impact officer at United Way in Richmond. So that means I oversee grant making for health and human services in our region. One of our goals is to eliminate social isolation for older adults and people with disabilities. There's a lot of science right now, and I think isolation is an issue that spans the ages, right? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of science, both biological science and social science, coming out now from all over the country and the world, really demonstrating and proving to us that when people are socially isolated, there are extreme consequences. They're more likely to die prematurely. People who are socially isolated are 7 times more likely to become depressed. If you're older adults, you're more likely to fall, to suffer hypertension, stroke, diabetes. But the flip is true as well. There is science that proves that when we have strong social connections and it's about quality, not quantity, when we have strong social connections and feel like we belong, we're healthier, our immune systems are stronger, we live longer, our cognition works better. So I really think it's nothing short of that that what is We Need Diverse Books is doing. It is creating, I mean, that's what stories do. They bind us together. Mm-hmm. So we can identify where we belong, and that is a bridge. I think a story is as much a bridge back out to a connection as anything.
Anybody else? I think as we agree that everyone in this room, we're probably all on board, but some of us do get pushback on the idea of diversity in books. Not just from that parent who takes the book out of a kid's hand, but I've heard things like, well, does that mean we have to lower our standards? Or why can't books just be colorblind? I read Rebecca when I was a African-American teenager, and I'm a reader. I didn't have to see myself on the covers of the books. Why can't books just be colorblind? What would you say to something like that? And these are all things I have heard.
Oh, of course. But, you know, it's interesting. I read Charlotte's Web. That was my favorite book as a little kid. And I grew up in Queens, New York. The only pig I ever saw was on Noche Buena on my table. That's it. I didn't know anything about farms and all of that. And boy, did I relate to that book about friendship and about loyalty and about being true. And so I insist that the same can be true of a book with a character of color as a main character, because we're talking about the universal horrors and beauties of growing up, right? That's what we do through different lenses, but that's what we do. With regard to like the whole colorblind thing, it's, you know, I think that it's more important. Not that we just say, I hear this also in publishers, also that we're afraid to take more authors of color and so on in case we have to lower our standards, blah, blah, blah. But I think the beauty really comes in seeing more color, not less. In seeing, it's sort of like you get this special set of glasses and suddenly you see all these shades you never saw before and all these ways of knowing and all of these beautiful traditions in there. I just think it makes the world richer and more exciting, not the other way. Any thoughts?
Okay. That's totally right. And why would you want to screen out, right? I mean, we don't, any of us, move through the world in this monochromatic or very one-dimensional world. I mean, our world, our families, our friends, the people we work with and worship with, it's everything. And so why would we want literature to screen out rather than kind of bring everything in, what you're saying?
And you know what's funny? When I read one of Gigi's books, I want to be from Mississippi. When I was reading the crossover, I was a basketball playing boy. You know, and do you know what I mean? You just get into those shoes, and what a healthy thing to do, to be able for a little while to be in someone else's shoes and problem solve the way they do and think about it the way they do.
Yeah, this reminds me of the story that Sarwat Chadha is a British British Indian author of a middle grade series called Ash Mystery. And he was talking to a bookseller and of how excited he was about this new series that he had written. And the bookseller stopped him and said, I just don't see the need to stock your book because there are no Indians in my neighborhood. To which he replied, I don't think there are any hobbits either, but.
Now, give me five.
Now that's a drop the mic moment right there. Drop the mic.
Use that one.
I always use that story.
So. Yes. Yeah. No wizards all, probably either.
Will you give us permission to steal that one?
We yes. all we want to use Sarwat. So.
Just real briefly, I write the last two novels I've written. One, middle grade, How I Became a Ghost, and more recently, House of Purple Cedar. It's young adult / adult crossover, and they're both different times, almost 100 years apart, but heavy on the conflict between American soldiers burning down homes, killing people, driving people on the trail. And then House of Purple Cedar on the conflict when white people in Oklahoma wanted the land and would do anything to get it. But I started out years ago, and I stay with this, that evil in nothing that I write will ever be identified by the color of a person's skin. That if the Army did this, if officials did this, the burnings, the whatever, that I will also create enough Anglo characters which care about the people who are being hurt, care about them, who reach out to them. In the same way that this room is filled with people of a variety of colors who will reach out to someone in need, regardless of the color of their skin, I try to do that in every book I write. I never identify good or evil by the color of a skin. Just great. Wanted to offer that.
Well, if anybody else has a last comment they want to make, and we'll move into questions and answers. And so while the folks are getting the mics positioned, I just want to just think that you had just added such amazing insight to the way you've been thinking about this, such an interesting cross-section of ideas. And I'm sure that our audience has some great questions to keep the conversation going. So we're going to have mics positioned in the front, in the middle, and in the back. And as soon as we get a mic up front, we've got a question right up front.
Thank you so much. I'm actually a teacher and a writer, but my question is twofold. I'm really interested in knowing, when you were a child, what book inspired you, or you know, that you basically couldn't put down, and then also what advice you have for children's lit students.
Meg?
Well, as a very little kid, I loved Charlotte's Web. I also read Nancy Drew. Just mesmerized by a lawyer father with a sports car. I mean, who were these people? But it was fabulous. So yeah, I read what was available to me at the time. When I got into college is when I started to read more Latino-centered literature. It was The House on Mango Street, which awakened. It was such a huge moment to see a Latino family in the pages. It was just shocking. The advice that I would give to writers, is that what you mean?
Children's literature writers.
Okay. People writing children's literature, is this. I think that we have the idea that you have to go outside for the story, have an amazing life, have amazing ideas, travel to this part of the world, that part of the world. And while that is fun, the place you really have to travel is within, to your own stories, to the things that frightened you as a child, the things that fed you as a child, the things that you remember that you can't understand why you remember. Jot them down and follow that for a while. And invariably, I think you come to the why it was important. I think that's what matters in writing children's books, that we really write their experience honestly and unflinchingly.
My father, who was an academic and a publisher and a writer, and my mother, who was a writer and an English professor, they made us read books in lieu of watching television. We got one TV show a week.
Gosh.
Mine was Different Strokes. Love Different Strokes. So they forced us to read books, and my sisters liked it. And when I was little, I liked Winnie the Pooh and all that stuff. But as I became a middle school student, I didn't like being forced to read. So I remember my father, it wasn't funny to me. So my father traveled a lot. So when he left, I would throw tantrums, and the way I would throw tantrums was I would take books off the shelf and throw them around the room. And I made sure I did it when he was gone. I wasn't stupid. But he told me, I remember he was leaving town, he was like, I want you to read this book, and I want it done by the time I get back. And it was this book, it had this gold seal on it. The author was this woman named Mildred Taylor. I was like, I'm not reading this junk. But I didn't want to, you know, I can't say get a spanking, so I didn't want to get disciplined. So I read it, and I loved it, and I wouldn't tell him that. But that was, I think, the first book that I couldn't put down. The advice I give to children's literature students is you want to write a world that is authentic, that is diverse. I believe you have to live an authentic in a diverse world. I think you have to travel. I believe you have to live this amazingly authentic life so you can have something worth writing about.
So I didn't like TV growing up because we had the old-fashioned TV, and I was the TV remote control. And, you know, if the weather was bad, I'd have to stand by the bunny ears. So I really, other than Saturday morning cartoons, I really didn't like TV. So I really was a voracious reader. I loved reading. But I can tell you that my favorite books were Alexandre Dumas, Count of Monte Cristo. I think that's why I have this revenge violence kind of thing in all my books. Revenge! But you know, I didn't actually know what I was missing until I read The Joyla Club when I was in my 20s. And that was, I tell you, Niagara Falls. I cried for months, and then the movie came out, and I cried for months after that too. Because for the first time ever, it was an Asian with immigrant parents, you know, like mine, and I was just like, you know, and I wish I had had that as a child, and my kids have a little bit more of that now, and I'm glad, but it's still not enough. Like, that's why my advice to children's lit students is please write more diverse books so all our kids can read about other cultures and themselves, not just mirrors, but reflections, because like I think Asian kids need to read The Crossover and Brown Girl Dreaming. You know, I think Latino kids need to read about Graceland's, you know, beautiful Where the Mountain Meets the Moon. It's not just white people, you guys have to read about us. Everybody. That I think that's really important for all of us. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When I hear about when she was a child and she was a remote, do you realize how old that makes me feel? Mercy. When I was a child, there was no TV. Right? And then I was 5 and the world changed. Oh, I was raised on Hardy Boys. I love the Hardy Boys. And real, like, fourth grade, I discovered Mark Twain, and I love Mark Twain. And in sixth grade, someone gave me a copy of To Kill a Mockingbird, and I was raised in the Texas Gulf Coast, which is closer to Louisiana and Mississippi in thinking than the rest of Texas. And when I started talking about To Kill a Mockingbird in class and teachers got silent, I knew I was onto something. I knew I was onto something there because challenge authority is what I was all about from the day I was born. I was onto something big time. So Steinbeck, Hardy Boys, To Kill a Mockingbird, and I'm very suspicious, but I'll have to read that second, the coming out soon, you know, book. But my advice to children's lit students who want to become writers is write what you know best. Read. I think it's very important to focus on the genre you want to specialize in, but I also write in several different genres. I've settled now on middle grade because I remember myself 4th through 7th grade, and that's where the ideas came that changed my life forever, that stayed with me, is that kind of middle grade, early young adult. But I think write what you know, and if you go back in your own mind, just thinking back in your mind through the different grade levels, and you come to a place that says, oh, I don't want to go there. Where you stub your toe, there the treasure lies. Where you stub your toe, there the treasure lies.
I like that. Did you just come up with that right now?
I like that too. Maybe.
I'm stealing that.
Yeah. That and the Hobbits. We'll go on.
Yeah.
I loved folk tales and fairy tales when I was little. The Little Match Girl was hands down my favorite. My Grammy would read that to me, and I would just be sobbing and then beg her to read it again. I think that's why my books are so sad. It's like something about the sadness, just sort of like it was like a moth to a flame. And then once I hit like 7th grade or so, I'm a first generation Judy Blume reader. And for me, like, are you there, God, it's me, Margaret. It was hard to get information from the women in my family about your period. It was just like, you couldn't get them to really deal with that. But so, there it was. What's happening to me? You know? Right. So it's funny, but it's true. Books can be also really, you know, kind of informative in that way. And I think the advice I would have to any children's writer or any writer really is to give yourself permission to use the natural world as a studio. The natural world is the most diverse thing around. Like, it's so diverse in terms of fauna and flora and plant life and how things interact. And it is also a place where it's very hard to be comfortable. You know, for most of us, for myself, as much as I love the outdoors, it always comes a moment when I'm like, and I'm ready to go in, because there's something uncomfortable happening. And that's, I think, a good place to write from feeling safe yet uncomfortable, so that you have to open up or break out a little bit. So I think in terms of diversity of all types, the natural world can lead us there as writers.
Great. I think we got a question in the middle. Right there, yeah.
Hi there. I'm interested in the language we use to talk about this. I train lots of volunteers. I work with all kinds of families. And I gotta say, when people say, you know, the diversity is so important, whatever, we need to teach tolerance, that just sets my teeth on edge, because tolerance implies that there's something bad to be tolerated. So I'd like to hear what you have to say about the language that we use that is genuinely embracing and inclusive, and how we get past, for some people it's code, meaning we don't really want to embrace it all, but for other people it's just the way we've always talked about this. So I'm interested in the language that we use going forward.
Buddy, wanna?
Meg.
Okay, well, what I can say is that I think that it's a slippery slope, right? So I have a daughter who's 24 who's got disability. She has intellectual disabilities. So over the course of 24 years, she has been other health impaired, developmentally delayed, mentally retarded, and intellectually disabled. And there was a time where you weren't allowed to call her disabled. It's been really interesting to watch how we struggle with our discomfort mm-hmm. around this topic. And I also think it's interesting to watch people have conversations about race, because everybody starts tripping over their own tongue. It's remarkable to see. I agree that tolerance to me implies that you're tolerating something that's annoying to you. Mm-hmm. So I hear what you're saying. I try to keep in mind that almost everyone I run into, there is a small minority of people who really see things from a very different perspective than I do. But most of the time, people are trying to get it right. They're not trying to do microaggressions. They're not trying to hurt me. They're not trying to be foolish. They're trying to get it right, and they're stumbling through trying to get to the other side. So I'm sort of thinking about Tim's bridge and trying to meet people where they are and say, come on over, sweetie, you can do it.
That's good. Anybody else want to weigh in on that?
I'm totally with Meg on this, because I do know that there is a younger generation of people who they have a harder time when they are faced with intolerance. They feel that it's not their job to educate, and it's not. That's absolutely true. It's not any of our jobs to educate anybody about their own bias, their prejudice, their racism. It isn't. But at the same time, I do think that when it comes from just ignorance, and there's not any malice or bad intent in it, when it comes from the place that it's societal, it's in our media, it's become so ingrained in everything that we've learned, you have to unlearn it. Sometimes you got to help them unlearn it. You know, so saying, you know, it's not my job to teach you about race, sometimes that's not the right answer. And I'm not, and I respect those who don't want to be those teachers. But I do think that there needs to be enough of us who say, well, here's what's wrong with the language you're using. Here's why it's problematic. You know, we can do better.
If you think about how quickly, or not, but we, there was a time when we were very tolerant of drunk driving in this country. It was okay. We made jokes about it. You know, we did all kinds of things. And then we began to, we were woke up, whoa, it's a whole lot of people dying. And maybe we shouldn't do this. And we began to change. We began to change. And the same thing is happening, I think, with sexual assault. We used to make jokes about it. We can change our language. We can change our perspective when we are motivated to do that. So I think that it will take time, and people will make mistakes and have to be backed up, and they'll be embarrassed. And but you know, embarrassment is not dead.
Right.
So the important, you can live to get unembarrassed. So I think we can give people the space they need. We all need to grow, and that we're all going to make. You know, it's going to take a while before we're all really on the page where we want to be. But the goal is to just keep moving in that direction.
Right. Yeah. And one thing I do say is to people. Yeah, being called a racist is nowhere near as bad as dealing with racism. So,
in the back, we've got a question in the back. Maybe all the way in the back? All the way in the back, yes.
Okay, I just, one question I wanted to know, how have you guys improved your writing skills, and will we see you at the National Book Fair in September?
You improve writing by writing and reading widely and just pushing yourself into every place of discomfort that you can find, just following it that way. And yes, I always come to the National Book Festival. It's such a party.
My writing is pretty amazing.
I can't.
However, I've written 18 books, and I heard three words from my dad that I've never heard. I always send him an autographed copy, and so I sent him the autographed copy of the 18th book, and he called me like a day later, and he said, "I read it," and that had never happened before. So I think he sort of set the bar. Because I'd like for him to continue to read those. Yes, I'll be at the National Book Festival.
I can't answer the question now. I too am a great writer. Nobody can edit me. I refuse. No, seriously though, like if you don't revise and if you don't take criticism well, you'll never grow as a writer. That's the most important thing I think I can say about writing. So revise, revise, revise. And when you think it's done, revise it some more. Because I think everybody writes that, except Kwame, everybody writes the first shitty draft and just have to, is it okay if I said that word? And we just have to embrace it. And I don't know if I'll be at the National Book Festival. I'd like to be.
Unlike the previous two respondents, I was raised to value humility. But on the other hand, I question authority. I'm pretty darn good, too, when it comes to writing. There you go. For writing habits, what works for me is I set a number of words per day, and regardless of what happens, I'm going to do it. If it means I have to do it on an airplane with my headphones, if it means I have to get up at 3 instead of 5, I'm going to do it every single day. And it doesn't mean that it's all quality work, but I think for someone to think that attending writing workshops all the time is going to make you a better writer would be like Michael Jordan watching films of basketball all the time and never going out on the court. I think what you said, it's doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it some more. And then making sure that you have an editor that's going to crack the whip and tell you you don't know what you're doing, you need to start over again enough until you become finally good at it, but doing it and doing it and doing
like
it.
Like Kwame.
All right, let me clarify that. Because I'm not liking the whole energy up here. There, you have to be confident in your work. Kathy Crutcher is here. She teaches students how to write and how to publish. She knows this. You have to be confident in your work. Young people have to be confident in their work. Because at the very basic level, if you don't feel that confident and that good about your work, then the people you sort of interact with, whether they be the students or editors or agents or publishers, then they aren't going to get that same energy. So yeah, I say it a little in jest. I mean, I get better because I put in the work. I'm getting better because I put in the work. But I am extremely confident in thinking that I know what I'm doing, in so much as, and I've talked about this a number of times with the crossover, it got rejected a lot of times. I kept getting told no, that it's not that good. And so at some point, you have to know that your work is good. You have to feel good about it. That's what I'm saying. Are we clear? All right.
Right.
Jeez.
God. We're clear. So I just want to say
some sugar this afternoon.
Right. We're clear. And I just want to say Meg's a great writer. And I'm a great writer. For real. If you don't know my work, I'll know. So what I'm interested in terms of improving writing is I'm really interested in practicing it. I love revising. Like, I sometimes will revise a book 30 times before it goes to anyone else who's reading it as a first draft. It might be my 30th draft. But I really like to, just integrate my daily practice with free writing. Because I really believe in free writing in terms of, like, setting your internal editor aside and bargaining with that internal editor to say, there's a job for you, there's a role for you, I need you. You have to be in on it, but not now. And really allowing my more island of mind, like that creative imagination, to just roll wherever it wants to go. And because I find that the mind is kind of like an attic in a way, right? If you go in with this flashlight, there are pieces there that maybe sometimes will come out whole or intact or an image or a feeling or a sentence that's right at the front of that wild mind of yours, and I just never knew it. So I like to incorporate a lot of free writing where I'm not working with an aim to finish a chapter or to revise a chapter or move toward the end of a story, but just to explore sort of what's there, what fragments and threads and ribbons and pieces are there to be kind of picked up and worked out.
Yeah. Before I would take the next question from the audience, I do have one from Katie Horning. And you know, Katie Horning is the director of the Cooperative Children's Book Center at the University of Wisconsin. And they, you know, they come up with all of the figures about the numbers of books by various groups in the country. And she asked a question for our panel, as an author of color, do you ever feel pressure from either your community or your publisher to write a specific kind of book?
Let me see. From my publisher, no. There are times where I feel like I'm writing, like this new novel that I have coming out in March called Burn Baby Burn. The character is Latina also, but banks heavily into her American side, more heavily than in previous books that I've written. And so I did have that uncomfortable question, like, is she Latina enough? Which is the eternal question of every bicultural kid, right? Am I Latino enough if I don't speak Spanish well, if I wasn't born there? Like, all of these weird things. So I think some of that rattles around in there. But I don't feel, I haven't felt the pressure yet.
I don't feel any pressure. I feel none whatsoever. I feel responsibility to write books that are meaningful and significant, in particular for kids who were like me when I was growing up at age 11, reluctant readers. I know we hate that word, some of us. I haven't figured out, or uninterested readers. So I feel responsibility to do that. I feel responsibility to write books that are mirrors and windows for my six-year-old daughter. I feel a responsibility, but I feel no pressure whatsoever from anyone.
Okay.
I agree. I'm the same way. But why I wrote was for my kids, too. Like, I have three girls, and I never found an Asian girl hero book, and so I wrote it. So for me, my next story is a ghost story, and what drives me to write stories is that it has to connect with me, and it has to be a book that I think is going to resonate with girls and boys that have not seen something like this before. Like, you know, I like to incorporate parts of my heritage and culture that are unusual. So I'm writing a ghost story that has Korean shamans in it. So the pressure, I guess, maybe is in myself, and I feel a responsibility, like Kwame said, but not from anything external.
Okay.
No, I have not felt any pressure to make anything more Indian, more Native American. I have with almost every publisher that I've dealt with, I've had to do some educating in terms of we're not all the same. We don't all come under that one big blanket that Navajos are so different from Choctaws, from Cherokees, from Algonquin. Totally different nations, different, you know, I've had to do some educating, but I haven't felt any pressure to make anything more Indian. I have, a couple of times in the last few years, I've had discussing new projects with editors, and I've been asked, it seems like everything you write there is a ghost that eventually shows up. I don't, you know, maybe something without a ghost or so many ghosts. I have interviewed thousands of Choctaws and known thousands of Choctaws in my life, and I have never met a Choctaw person that has not themselves had a personal experience with what we call them Shalombish, we call them Gombefores, we call them whatever, but I've never met a Choctaw in my life that has not had a personal experience with someone who has gone before. So when I write novels, it's a natural thing for me to include that.
Gigi, did you want to weigh in about pressure to write a certain way or certain?
Sure. Well, I think we established earlier that I'm white. You don't believe it. I do feel a responsibility. I haven't written characters of color. I feel two responsibilities there as a writer. One, to create enough pause in my process and in my life to step back and kind of reflect on where my own bias is. I think we all come to our lives with bias based on the families we were raised in, the cities we were raised in, the year we were born, our cultural and racial background. But I believe we can become aware of those biases. And then we have a choice. The choice is to change and grow as a person, grow out of that bias, or to examine it and say, I keep it, I own it, right? And so one bias I have is that the ultimate place we all are coming from and going to is a place of love. That's a bias, and it's a bias that I believe. So I think I have a responsibility to, as a white writer and as a human being, to create pause in my life and in my work, to identify my bias. And also when I'm writing any character, and particularly characters whose life experience is different than mine, and this is something that that Jacqueline Woodson taught me. I think that I have a responsibility to be able to identify myself, know where I am in every character. If I see myself in every character, then we're together, and we're coming from that, you know, kind of same human place.
I think we have time for one more question.
I'm Claudette McLean from the Center for the Study of Multicultural Children's Literature. And I've recently served on book award committees and recently the Kirkus Prize Committee. And we all know that when there are a lack of diverse books in the field of publishing, and so we know that it's a problem. So the question is, how do you think we can solve this, since you the authors, the award-winning authors, give us a clue how you think we can solve this.
Well, this is coming to you guys, so be thinking right here. I would say one simple thing that I'd like librarians and teachers to do. We typically put up the poster of the Caldecott and the Newbery, but there are other awards, right? The American Indian Award and the Pura Belpre, the Tomas Rivera, the Coretta Scott King. I think we need to give children an awareness of the books that speak all the experiences so that they and their families have a way, visual, implied, everywhere in the building of places where they can find the best examples of the literature that reflects their people. That's just one tiny thing, but there is no one single answer, but I would love it if I would see that.
You want to start the other end, or?
I'd say if I could pick one thing, it would be for children to write, to give children the tools and the space and the power to write their stories, and to not be so hung up on the correctness of those stories initially, but the heart of those stories and the identity that's kind of coming through. Because every sixth grader's got a novel in his backpack, right? And wants to get it to your agent. They're all there.
I agree with that answer. I think my challenge, and I took it when I stepped out after defending my thesis, University of Oklahoma, Dr. Gary Hobson, who's an amazing American Indian poet, he said, so you've collected all these stories, you're doing all this writing given you by the elders, it's time for you to start passing them on. It's time for you to start mentoring. And I think that's the challenge, is for myself as an American, as a Choctaw writer, to begin to teach, to begin to mentor, to begin to encourage, to develop a writing relationship with the coming generation. And I should mention, just to honor him, that Greg Rogers, who 20 years my younger and followed me for 10 years, neither of us ever wrote anything without the other one seeing it before it went to anyone else, and he up and died of a heart attack a week before Christmas at University of Illinois. He was on a fellowship there, creative writing department, and I just wanted to mention him. But so now my challenge is to find more, to find people that I can mentor and teach, and that will help.
I think that's why we need diverse books is a good place to start, because we are having grants and awards and mentorships and internships to get more diverse candidates into publishing itself, because publishing itself is very white. And part of the problem is when editors who have no context about a different culture or background get a book that they have no knowledge of. What they need also the training. They need people that they can turn to. But if you have an industry that's, you know, very white, then who are they looking to? Who are they talking to? So that is also part of the problem. But I think ultimately, like everybody is saying, you know, you mentor, you get new people on board, you have other, you know, you have white authors also embrace diversity in their own writing, and you have to support the books. You have to support the books. And as teachers and librarians, when you're faced with a person who says, no, that's not for me, in a positive way, without getting into a fight, just keep pushing it. I mean, you know, like at some point, maybe that, no, that's not for me might actually change to, okay, I keep coming across this book, maybe I should finally read it. Maybe I should let my kid read it. You know, that opening of the mind, I think instead of saying, oh, this person is never going to be open to diversity, we just have to keep trying. We have to keep pushing that message out.
There was this school in Aurora, Illinois, and they emailed and said, the librarian, her name's Lynn White, she said, Kwame, I love the crossover, and I think I'm going to have all of our students read it. I was like, cool. How many students do you have? She's like, we have 800 students. I was like, cool. Are you going to buy 800 books? I was like, call first book. Let's make this happen. So she's like, yeah, so we're going to read the book. It's going to be one book, one school. Great. So she said, and then we want to bring you in. I was like, cool, bring me in. So they all read the book, and they brought me in. And on the way from the airport, she's telling me how students have really identified with this character, or this brother, or this poem. And I'm like, cool, this is awesome. And then we get to the school, and she says, now, I just want to let you know, our school is not that diverse. And I'm like, okay. And the school is like 97, 98% white. And to see these students sort of identifying with these characters in this book about these two boys with their dad and their mom was really just awesome. Because the kids had decided that any conversation, discussion about race, color, was not a part of their being able to connect with this text. They were able to connect with this text, which was inevitably about two black boys, because of the story and the message and the jealousy and the brotherhood and the family and the love. And so in my mind, what that says to me is that it is not the children who need to change in order for us to solve this problem that you so eloquently asked. It is us. We just need to change the way, because the kids are fine, we need to change the way we're thinking about it.
Thank you.
Let's give everybody another round. It's fabulous. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you so much.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.